The weather's been nice, and the honors given to the two women's basketball players are even nicer. I'm Gia Lancey.
And I'm Tyler Small. With the A-10 tournament coming up, the Salle men's basketball team has one more game to fill, but for the A-10 tournament, they have a pretty good A-1 chance. It's 11, actually. You're watching LaSalle TV's home for Explorer Athletics SportsLine.
Men's and women basketball is nearing the end, but do not fear, as spring season is here.
And later, I sat down with two of those spring athletes to talk about the start of the season and the look ahead for the long run.
But first, let's take a look at our SportsLine top three.
Number one, senior Shalina Miller and freshman Claire Jacobs have earned end of the year honors and recognition by the Atlantic 10 Conference. The conference announces on Thursday that Miller was named to the 6-player all-defensive team and Jacobs to the 5-member all-rookie team. The awards were voted by the league's 14 head coaches. Miller became the 4th Explorer ever to be named to the all-defensive team after leading the league in blocks with 80 and blocks per game at 2.7 this year. The Philadelphia native broke the school's all-time blocks record by 42 deflections and reset the single-season mark, which she recorded a season ago with 16. She'll also end her career 15th all-time in the Atlantic 10 with 193 career blocks. Jacobs, a 2-time Rookie of the Week, had a significant first season for the Blue and Gold. She led the team in scoring from the first game and concluded the year with 13.7 points per game. The Perth, Australian native recorded a LaSalle freshman record in points, 412, surpassing Michaela Owens with 411 points in 2013 and 2014. Jacobs also set a new program mark for the freshman points in a game with 29, which she did on two different occasions. She is the 7th Explorer to land on the list and the first since Owens. Overall, Jacobs finished 8th in the league in scoring and 2nd among rookies.
Number two, softball's Courtney Shepp earned A-10 Player of the Week with her performance in the Lobo Classic last weekend. The senior hit 462 with 6 hits in 13 plate appearances. Her hits include 2 homers, including a grand slam, while she drove in 8 runs and scored 3 herself. Shepp's honor is the first time since April of 2017 that a softball player has won the award.
And number three, LaSalle Volleyball has added to its coaching staff for the 2020 season. Head coach Andrew Kroger announced on Monday. Joe Loares, a 3-time Atlantic 10 champion with Dayton, will join the Explorers as an assistant coach. Loares played in 105 matches across her 4-year career with the Flyers, winning conference championships in 2012, 2014, and 2015. She was named to the all-team tournament as her senior year, recording 25 kills and 6 total blocks in 2 games. With Loares and Fold entering the second season at the helm, the Blue and Gold will aim for more success in 2020. The Explorers advanced to the A-10 semifinals for the 2nd consecutive year and earned a first-ever NIVC berth last season.
Yeah, so I mean, we can start off with women's basketball since there was a lot to talk about
there. Yeah, there was.
Two great, really great honors. And it's really nice to see Shalina Miller as a senior leaving and passing the torch off to some rookies like Claire Jacobs. Mm-hmm. But obviously there's some more talent upcoming too.
Yeah, of course. I mean, there's going to be a big void there for the Explorers. I mean, we talk about just the shot blocking for her, but at the same time, such an off-the-court leader. She really held the team together. But
absolutely.
At the same time, Claire is easily become the leader on the court, offensively and defensively. And at the same time, she's going to do it off the court. She has a great relationship with them. But that's all we have for top three. Now we're going to see how our teams did in this week's recaps. The LaSalle men's basketball team was leaping their way into victory after they picked up a 73-65 win over St. Bonaventure on February 29th. Not only was it Leap Day, but it was Senior Day, as Isaiah Dees, Saul Fieri, and Mustapha Diagne were honored prior to tip-off. Dees scored a team-high 16 points, which makes his career total just 970 points, just 30 away from 1,000. The Explorers' bench was strong against the Bonnies, as freshman Sharif Kenny scored 16 points and junior David Beattie scored 11. As a result, the bench had a 25-6 advantage. Freshman Christian Ray matched his career-high 10 rebounds, and freshman point guard Ayinde Hakeem added 6 assists. The Explorers, that was the end of the Explorers home season, but LaSalle hosted the UMass Minutemen, as Beattie had a career night, dropping a career high in points with 20, assists with 6, and steals with 4. The Blue and Gold would lead early, but after giving up an 8-1 run, the Explorers would never be able to catch up and close the gap, dropping the final home game 75-64.
Women's basketball had their final regular season game last Saturday. They took on George Mason in Virginia. The first quarter was close when they ended it with only a 1-point advantage. LaSalle was leading for most of it, but George Mason had a 6-0 run to end the first. In the second, the Blue and Gold outscored the Patriots 19-11 to retake the lead. After intermission, George Mason came out strong when they outscored LaSalle 8-7 in the first 5 minutes of the third. Mason cut their deficit to make it a 5-point game going into the third. Mason made it a 1-point game at three different times, but LaSalle eventually pulled out the win. They then took on Davidson on Tuesday in the first round of A-10s. LaSalle came in ranked 10th and Davidson was 7th. The last three matchups between the two teams have been taken by Davidson, but throughout the first quarter, it went completely back and forth. At that point, sophomore Kayla Sproul scored 7 of the team's 9 points. At the end of the first, Davidson took the advantage and were leading 23-13. The Wildcats added 5 more to their score before the Explorers went on a 10-0 run that forced a Davidson timeout. LaSalle came back from a 13-point deficit to lead the game by 1 point at the half. LaSalle kept their lead throughout the third until Davidson had an 11-2 run. To end the third stanza, in the fourth, LaSalle scored 7 unanswered to bring the score closer but could not pull through in the end when the Wildcats had 6 of the last 9 points and ended the Explorers' season. But on a good note, freshman Claire Jacobs broke the all-time scoring record in program history with 412 points.
The men's track and field team did not come home empty-handed as 2 Explorers took the gold at the Atlantic 10 Indoor Championship. In the preliminaries, the blue and gold had a solid showing. Senior Nathan Gillis placed first in the 1,000 meters, while classmate Anthony Hawthorne led the pack in the 800-meter run. Gillis returned in force the following day, again placing first in the 1,000 meters with a final time of 2 minutes, 29.31 seconds. Senior Darian Alston earned this team's second gold, edging out 12 competitors and setting a season leap of 15.10 meters in the triple jump. Hawthorne excelled in the 800-meter on the final day, but ended with silver, having ran in only 2.02 seconds behind gold.
Women's track and field also competed in the A-10 Indoor Championships this weekend. On day one of the competition, sophomore Elle Mancini placed fourth in the 5,000-meter run. In the distance medley relay, a team of Jeruca Lufrano, Michaela Eberle, Sammy Miller, and Liz Mancini placed fifth. Their time was just over 12 minutes. On the field, Jessica Bryant leapt to eighth out of 29 jumpers in the long jump. Freshman Christine Mancini qualified for the 1,000-meter final, turning in the fifth fastest time. On day two, the 4x800 team of Sammy Miller, Jerica Lufrano, Christine Mancini, and Michaela Eberle took the bronze. In the 1,000-meter final, Christine Mancini took fourth, finishing with a season best of 2 minutes and 55 seconds. Jessica Bryant finished her indoor track career with a 9th-place finish in the triple jump.
The baseball team are on a 3-game losing streak, unfortunately, after dropping a game against Sacred Heart, Brown, and Delaware State. Senior Ryan Guckin, junior Jack Cucinata, and freshman Elijah Dickerson helped the Explorers to an 8-0 lead against Sacred Heart in the first 5 innings, but were soon devastated by an 8th-inning rally by the Pioneers to drop the game 10-9. Next up was Brown, where starting pitcher Manny Corporan kept the Bears scoreless in the first 4 innings, while sophomores Tatum Levins, Dickerson, and Guckin shined to keep the game level at 3 apiece. As the game entered extra innings, a walk-off double by Brown ensured an Explorers loss 4-3. The Explorers' bad luck persisted when they traveled to Delaware State, where an early 3-run lead was quickly overturned by a 3-run 5th inning seen by the Hornets, and things were knotted up at 5. At 2 runs in the 7th and 8th inning allowed Delaware State to come away with a 9-5 victory.
Softball continues its rough start once again, dropping all 4 games, this time at the Lobo Classic in New Mexico. It started with a close 3-4 loss against South Dakota. After going down early, the Explorers bounced back with an RBI from Kaylee Piven and a 2-run bomb from Ashley Mendenhall to give them a 3-1 lead. Unfortunately, the Coyotes answered with a 3-run sixth to take the win. Next was a game against host New Mexico. The scoring opened with a grand slam from senior Courtney Shupp. The lead wouldn't last long as the Lobos composed a 7-run inning to take the lead. New Mexico would hold that lead, winning 11-7. In Game 3, the Blue and Gold were blown out by Northern Colorado, losing 16-2. The final game was a rematch against New Mexico, where LaSalle once again faced the all-too-familiar Mercy Rule, with the game ending after 5 innings.
The women's lacrosse team had their home opener over the weekend against Radford. After being down a goal in the first few minutes of the match, the Explorers dominated. The Blue and Gold controlled the game from 3 on out, scoring 8 goals in the second half alone. Junior Anina Lekbuchi led the way with a hat trick, and to take down Radford ended in a score of 12-5. Next up, the Blue and Gold traveled to Lehigh. LaSalle was able to jump on an early lead, which was answered back by the opposing team. Most of the match was back and forth scoring. Junior Emily Johnston recorded a brace to put the Explorers back on top. However, a hot streak from the home side put the Explorers back down. Efforts were made to make another comeback, including 4 goals scored by junior Allison Hunter. Unfortunately, the efforts came up just a bit short as the Blue and Gold fell to Lehigh 18-15.
That's it for recaps, but when we come back, Tyler will sit down with baseball's Manny Corporan and Bubba Weigel. Check it out.
According to the Mayo Clinic, exercising has stress-busting benefits by bumping up your endorphins and improving your mood.
Week we got I got to sit down not you you weren't there I got
there.
To sit down with Bubba Weigel and Manny Corporan from the baseball team. Why don't we take a look? Hello and welcome to this week's edition of On the Sideline. Today I get Manny Corporan and Bubba Weigel in studio today. Guys, thank you for coming by.
Of course.
Yeah. All right, so we're gonna dive right in. So for both of you, this is both your first seasons here at LaSalle. What has the transition been like to playing for the Explorers, and do you have any upperclassmen that have helped you throughout the process?
So for me, as a pitcher, there's a couple of guys that I seem to look up to. The main one being Colin Scanlon. He's our Friday guy.
Right.
He's helped me out a lot. Like, he's helped me like get to know like everyone else. Like, he was one of the first people that I met once I got here, because I'm a transfer from FDU.
Yeah.
And he's helped me like, you know, get used to like the LaSalle culture and everything that LaSalle's about. And he's always there to like back me up. Another guy would be Colin Kennedy. I've gotten really close with him too. And just like Scanlon, he's helped me like, you know, just get used to like the way LaSalle runs things.
Awesome.
And for me, a guy that I think of a lot is Ryan Guckin. Senior,
right.
We both play first base, so there's a little friendly competition there.
Yeah.
And he's like someone who I like look up to as like an older brother type figure.
Mm-hmm.
And we room together when we travel on the road, so that like that helps out a lot. He's you know, when we played Furman, he was like getting my mind right before the game and just telling me things to focus on instead of like, you know, thinking like negative thoughts. He was like, all right, you can do this, you got this. So
yeah.
Nice to have that in your corner.
No,
like that.
Definitely, it's nice. And it's kind of cool that for both of you, you almost have that competitive edge where you stay in the rotation while you stay at your position battle. So
yeah, for sure.
Yeah. It's great to see. So kind of go personal for the next couple of questions. Manny, you just recently, last week, won the Big Five Pitcher of the Week. What does an honor like that mean to you?
I mean, to me, like, it means a lot, obviously, but I try to, you know, obviously I accept it, you know, means a lot to me because, you know, I can see that all my hard work's like paying off. But at the end of the day, it's just pitcher of the week. There's always there's always next Sunday. So I just got to, you know, just throw it out the bag and just focus on my next outing.
Great, great. And then for Bubba, Bubba's not your actual name. Kind of tell us the story behind that.
Well, my real name is Luke, but nobody really knows that. When I say that, people are like, oh, who's that?
Yeah.
So when I was younger, my my family has like some German heritage, and Buva, it means like big little boy or something like that. So that was like my nickname when I was just like a newborn. And then it quickly changed into Bubba. And then when I was growing up, like on the baseball field, my dad would say Bubba. My teammates would start calling me Bubba.
Right.
So then as I went up, I was like, yeah, I kind of like that. So I stuck with it. So then all my buddies started calling me Bubba. And here I am stuck with the nickname. So yeah.
Stuck is right. Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. So us at SportsLine, we were here for the home series. And we really saw throughout, even though it was a doubleheader on a cold Saturday, you guys had a loud dugout, a lot of energy coming from it. How big is that for a doubleheader for you if you're pitching the later halves of an inning to have your team behind you?
It's like super important just so everybody is like, you know, into the game, and you look on the bench like when you step out of the box or something, everybody's like up and, you know, having full energy. It seems you just like, all right, let's go. Like this at bat actually means something instead of like your fifth at bat of the day on a cold Saturday. Could get kind of dreary, but when you look in there and everybody's like cheering you on, it's like, all right, yeah, they got my back. Like, let's go. This is fun. Yeah.
Plus, as a pitcher, it's actually like huge when you're out there just trying to compete, and you look over to your dugout and you know that every single one of the players on your team have your back. Like, no matter like what goes down, like they'll always be there to back you up. And like, you know, if you're doing good, they'll always be there to hype you up. So it's a great feeling.
I think it's super important too, because there's a lot of guys that don't play every day. Yeah. And when they're into the game, you're like, all right, this means a lot. So it's cool to see that. And I think that's a big step up from what we saw last year. We have I redshirted last year, so I was part of the team, but didn't play at all. It's like a huge step up in our like culture and everything. And it's just awesome to be a part of that. So
great. Great. Yeah. So the next thing is you guys have a very explosive offense to start the season so far, averaging 6 runs a game. So for many, how great is that to pitch with that behind you? Because your ERA is half of that. And how fun is it being a part of that offense that can explode in an instant?
So for me, it's amazing. I mean, like, I used to always get made fun of because every time I would have a good outing, I didn't really have an offense behind me that would back me up. But, like, LaSalle is completely different. I know that, you know, I can let up, you know, 3-4 runs a game and still be able to come out with a win at the end of the day. So, yeah, it's huge.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
And when you're hitting in a lineup that scores all those runs, it kind of gets you amped up to want to go out in there and hit again. Hitting is always, like, contagious. I always heard my dad say that, and coaches throughout, like, growing up say, hitting is contagious. Once one guy gets a hit, everybody seems like they start hitting. Yeah. So it's a good thing to be a part of, for sure.
Yeah, and you definitely saw that in the Scanlon start of that game, really being able to come back for that doubleheader. Next question I kind of have is, we have a brand new turf field here this season. You got to see it a little bit last year, the difference that it's seen. What do you guys prefer, dirt or turf?
I mean, as a pitcher, for me, it's kind of tricky. I like turf because, you know, it's a little bit more consistent. So, like, you know, you don't have to worry about holes on the mound or people, you know, digging, like, massive holes where you're trying to, like, push off, like, the rubber. But once you go to, like, a nice dirt field, there's nothing like it.
Right.
But, like, it's kind of rare to find, though, but
yeah,
once you do, it's actually amazing. So
right.
I don't really have a preference. It depends. So.
Right.
Yeah. I for fielding balls at first base, I think I'd rather have a turf field just because of true hops and not having to worry about the lip at first base between the grass and the dirt. But there is nothing better than playing on like a nice dirt field. So just like, you know, it feels like, all right, I'm gonna make a diving play, get dirty, get up and wipe the dirt off. That's a good feeling. But turf is nice, so I like where we play.
Dirty jersey is a sign of a great game.
Yeah, you know, for that sure. Means.
All right, so last question we have. We're gonna end on kind of a fun one. 9 of you versus 9 of you. 9 Mannies versus 9 Bubbas. Who wins that game?
Me. Right.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So, I don't know. Our pitching staff is full of athletes. So, like, we can do a whole bunch of stuff.
Pitchers are athletes.
And I'm not sure we have a position player that can just step on that rubber and just be, you know, like a fear factor.
Right.
So, like, I'm pretty sure as a pitching staff, we'll be able to put the ball in play and be able to make things happen.
Okay.
And obviously, on the other side, we're pitchers. So, you know, I think we'll come out on top 100%.
All right.
I disagree. I disagree wholeheartedly on that one. I think that a pitcher trying to hit is a lot harder than a hitter trying to pitch. Mm. So I think me throwing a fastball down the middle, Manny will pop it up every time. So, and I think him throwing a fastball down the middle, I'll hit off the fence every time. So we'll see how that goes.
How hard to throw in, Manny? You have any other pitches? Or?
I'd probably throw 82 with a 75 mile an hour changeup and a decent curveball.
All right. We'll see if you can hang back on that one.
Yeah, I definitely will. I'm underestimated.
All right, well, Manny, Bubba, thank you so much for coming today. And I'm going to send it back to the desk. Well, thank you, Tyler, along with Manny and Bubba. They were great. We're going to take another quick break, but when we return, we welcome a new face to represent the prestigious Explorer Report honor. Stay tuned to see who it is.
They're kind of close to an egg.
An egg?
An egg.
How does someone like, how does a general lose to an egg?
The internet's to an egg.
You know, there is a show for that. It's called Backstage Pass.
See the new library plans?
No, I haven't.
Yeah, doing stuff in the library.
Huh. In the library?
Yeah.
New library.
You know, there is a show for that called LTV News, where the action never stops.
I wonder how the basketball team.
You know, there is a show for that called SportsLine.
So are you a Carson Wentz or Nick Foles guy?
More of a Nate Sudfeld
type. Oh, really?
Interesting.
Wonder where we can hear about Philly sports.
You know, there's a show for that called Sports Talk Philadelphia.
You like Family Feud?
Yeah.
You like all shows like that?
Yeah.
I wonder if LaSalle has a show like that. That'd be kind of cool.
There is a show for that called Q&A.
I really wish that we could just, like, display our talents.
Yeah, me too.
There is a show for that called Explorers Got Talent.
All this and more on LaSalle TV.
Before we get to this week's Explorer Report, here are some upcoming sporting events happening this week, starting with this Friday, where the men's tennis team travels to Delaware to take on the Blue Hens.
Track and field will be heading to the ECAC Indoor Championships for the weekend, while lacrosse travels to New York to take on LIU Brooklyn.
Women's water polo goes cross-country to face off in the Occidental Conference Cup in California.
Looking at the diamonds, baseball travels down to Virginia for a three-game series against Richmond, while softball stays home to host George Mason for a doubleheader.
And lastly, we have men's basketball, who ramps up for the A-10 tournament, but they have one more game to take care of business. And for that, we are going to welcome on Anthony to talk about this week's Explorer Report.
Thanks, Tyler. On Saturday, March 7th, the men's basketball team visits Hawk Hill, hoping to get another win over their Big Five rival. Last time the two Philly teams met, LaSalle sent St. Joe's back home with an 83-66 defeat. It was LaSalle's fourth straight win over the Hawks at home. LaSalle comes in at 14-15 overall and 5-12 in the A-10, where St. Joe's are having trouble keeping an even record at 6-24 and 2-15 in conference. LaSalle hoped to revive a winning streak after losing Wednesday night 75-64 to UMass. Even though LaSalle dropped its home finale to Massachusetts, there were some positives to carry on to St. Joe's. Tallying career highs in points, assists, and steals, David Beattie has been showing promising signs that this season is far from over for the junior guard. He finished the night with 20 points, 6 assists, and 4 steals. Senior Safiri also trailed a career high in steals with 4 while adding 13 points and 8 rebounds. LaSalle carried the night with 11 steals. The Hawks faced Bonnies and couldn't get a win. However, with two players tallying over 20 points in Cameron Brown and Ryan Daly, LaSalle must keep a high alert on the defensive side. St. Joe's also have much to worry as LaSalle seek to gain another victory against their rivals.
Thanks, Anthony. All right, so let's talk about this a little bit. Mm-hmm. So this St. Joe's team, not good. So if we lose to this team, it
not
is
good.
Embarrassing.
Yeah, no, not really a hot take. I mean, we really talked about before, we actually had an Explorer Report with Josh, I believe, earlier, where we talked about St. Joe's, and mm-hmm. they're just highlighted is around Ryan Daly. Averaging 20 points a game, he has the highest efficiency rating on the team. But coming to watch him, he really wasn't as special. They're kind of empty stats. I mean, he's not the trademark athlete that you would think he would be. Not to say he's unathletic, but I think that this Explorers team and Coach Ash really gets them into tip-top shape, as you know. So
yeah,
really
and
being able to
with the help of the fitness coach this year too.
Yeah,
so
no,
never
exactly.
Had that before.
No, yeah, just a deep coaching staff overall, and they were able to outrun St. Joe's at home. So I don't see why it'll be any different on the road. Not a long travel, so the legs will be ready. But
yeah, definitely.
I mean, it's just a different look for this team as well. I mean, Kimbrough's really been able to step up since Ed Croswell announced he's going to transfer.
Right,
as
right.
We won't get too far into.
Yeah.
But David Beattie has been on another planet lately.
Yeah.
Kimbrough's averaging 10 points a game since he's been starting those past two games. But
right.
Beattie, he just had a career night, as we mentioned earlier, a career high in points with 20, assists with 6, steals with 4 in the game against UMass.
Yeah.
Losing effort, but, I mean, this Explorers team is different.
Yeah, I mean, I hope so. And, I mean, St. Joe's, they have, I think, 1, maybe 2 conference wins, so that's not looking too good. And, I mean, I think the 1 was just because Ryan Daly had a lucky shot at the end.
The most unreal buzzer beater I've ever seen.
You're
I mean,
right.
All the credit in the world to him. What a phenomenal play. But, yes, it's... Explorers definitely have the upper hand in this. They should be favored.
Yeah, they should be, but you never know. So let's go to our picks. I have 80-74 LaSalle winning.
I also have the blue and gold taking it 84-71.
Yeah, and let's see what Anthony picked.
I have LaSalle winning 76-66 against the Hawks.
Yeah, so I think we're pretty positive about this, so.
Yeah, we'll have to see. Again, it's staying in the city, so it should be able to stay with fresh legs. I can't stress that enough, so. For this Explorers team, I mean, it's going to be a full valiant effort, and it's going to come down to the freshmen as well. Ayinde Hakeem has really taken a better leadership role. Christian Ray's been starting the past couple of games. He put up 7 points in the last game, so that's going to be huge.
Yeah.
And then, of course, that senior presence, Salfiri Isaiah Dees, they don't want the first round of the playoffs to be their last. So when we get to the A-10s,
right.
This is a great marker to play your best game, pick up a huge road win, and then you travel to Brooklyn and
shock the world. I mean, they will get so much confidence from this win, too. I mean, I think... it's essential for them to come off a win and go into the A-10s. But
yeah.
All right, well, that just about wraps it up for us this week. If you can't make it out to see this week's Explore Report, be sure to tune in next week for our coverage. Keep up with this weekend's other sporting events by visiting GoExplorers.com or check out this week's edition of The Collegian.
Also, check us out on Facebook at Facebook.com/LaSalleTV and on Twitter at SportsLineLTV. We welcome you to send your thoughts and suggestions there.
For Isaiah and our SportsLine team, I'm Gia Lancey.
And I'm Tyler Small. Thanks for joining us, and we will see you at the game.